toe tapping, hand clapping, face clapping song as we enter the Word of God. One of the things I love about some of the music we play is that there's something about music which can lift us up, isn't it? And it's not always the words, sometimes it's the beat and the rhythm, and it draws us up. And it's great that we can engage with God's Word, we can hear God's Word, but sometimes when we listen to the Word of God, when we hear someone preach, the response is something like this. And it's great that we can actually engage with God's Word, and I'm hoping today that that's not the response. So I do, however, have insurance when we're here. If I see you fall asleep, I'm going to draw a moustache on you. All right, so fair warning. Some of your eyebrows, yeah, get that out of there. All right. Today we're talking about a brief history of everything in 20 minutes. So have your stopwatches out. Let's see if I can get through it all. Who remembers last week's message? Who was here? We had a guy by the name of Phil, who was bald, who wasn't me, speaking. He was a missionary from Papua New Guinea. And he challenged us to be obedient. How much? 100%. Not 50%. Not 10%, not 90%, 100% obedient. That God expects our obedience, and rightly so. One of the biggest issues in our lives is sin. It's the biggest problem we have, and it leads us to disobedience, a lack of faith, to selfishness. But if we can put those things aside and be obedient to God, then we will fulfill everything that He expects us to do. We talk about history. You ever heard someone say that history is the story? You don't have to put a double S in there, but history is his story. In a lot of ways, that's true. We're going to look a little bit about that, not only the world history, but our own history today. We're going to have our reading. It comes from Luke. If you have your Bibles, open to Luke 24. I wanted to just have a couple of verses out of this story because I didn't want us to go through the whole story today. I want to reflect a bit on this story and what's actually happening in this story. I love this narrative in Scripture. It's the end of Luke. It's a story that happens after the resurrection, on Resurrection Sunday. Let's just think about it for a moment. Jesus has just been through the whole Passion Week, the crucifixion. He's been away for 3 days. Work tends to stack up when you're away. And he's back. He's been resurrected. This is the first day back, the day of resurrection. You would think he'd have a few people he'd need to talk to. So pretty significant people would need to know that he's back. It'd have to be Peter and the apostles, and you probably want to go and see the religious leaders and say, "I told you so." Probably a few things he wanted to get off his chest. And yet here we have a story that on the first day, Jesus spends not only 10 minutes, not just a few minutes, a couple of hours of this first day with two of the disciples, one of whom doesn't even make a mention of his name. And the other one, we only hear of, this is the only time we hear of Cleopas. Actually, an Egyptian name. We don't hear of any other times in the scripture where this guy is mentioned. They're not significant players in the story, and yet Jesus has time to spend a couple of hours on this first day with them. That's pretty amazing. Because if Jesus has time for these two guys, who don't rank anywhere else in scripture, they don't even appear elsewhere in scripture, then he probably has time for me. I think that's pretty incredible. That God would be willing in Jesus to spend time with these people. Now, if it was me, I would have gone to Peter and to Andrew and to James and to John and all these guys. That would have been my first day. You set your priorities and you get these things in order. So maybe it's a good thing that it wasn't me. This is part of what makes up the good news, the gospel. You know, in Greek, the word gospel and good news are the same word. And the Greek word is euangelios. It's made up of two words, good and news. Imagine that. It's where we get the word evangelism from. But I want to ask you something. What is the good news? If we as a Christian community were asked, what is the good news? What is the good news? Most of us would point up here, wouldn't we? I mean, that's why we have it on our wall. Because the good news is that Jesus died for your sins. Yeah? That is good news. However, I don't think that's all of it. Let me give you an example. When we talk about the good news, we talk about the death and the resurrection of Jesus. We know what it means to us. We as Christians have experienced it. We know what relationship with God is like. But to a world outside, to a people who don't know all about it and haven't experienced it, it's a little bit like this. Do you remember there used to be a show on TV called The Money or the Box? Remember that? I need a volunteer. Who can I pick on? Go on, Emma. All right. I have in my hand two things. Okay. A roll of 50s and a box. Now we're going to shake this box, okay? What's that sound like? Nothing. Okay, can you hold the box? What does it feel like?
Pretty light.
Pretty light? Not much there? Okay. Now, I'm going to offer you the money or the box. And hang on, there's a catch though, okay? The money you can have, but the box you can't open until you die. All right. You can have whatever's in it, but you can't open it until you die. Which would you choose? Probably the money. Is there anyone who wouldn't choose the money? Anyone would choose the box in the game of the money and the box? You wouldn't, would you? A box of nothing. Or all the money and everything else. And thank you, sit down. That's not what the gospel's about. But when people hear us say that Jesus died for your sins, therefore repent, this is what they see. They say, well, I can have all of this stuff. I mean, I quite enjoy my sin. I can have all of these things, or you want to give me something that I can't even open until I die, and even then it's too late for me to experience it. We know that's what it's about, but that's what they hear. When they hear us say that the good news is that Jesus died for your sin, that's what they hear. And we've just attested ourselves that anyone in their right mind would choose the money. Because the gospel, if it is just Jesus died for your sins, does not make sense. That is not good news to people who don't know Jesus. See, when we talk about the gospel, we talk about it in very limited terms. If we were to look at the gospel, it didn't actually come up. That's all right. Our slides didn't go in. That's all right. If we were to look at it as an iceberg, You know about the iceberg? Probably the Titanic, not many of us are on the Titanic, but the Titanic, how much of the iceberg do you see above the water? 10%. Not much. We talk about the gospel as though everything that we see in the death and the resurrection of Jesus is all there is to the gospel, but that's just the tip of the iceberg, literally. Just the very tip. You know, when Jesus sends out the 12 and the 72, he sends them out to preach the what? Good news. The good news of the kingdom. So they could not have been preaching that Jesus died for your sins, because you know what? He hadn't died yet. The good news is bigger than that. And so we look at the life of Jesus and we say, here is the good news lived out in Jesus' life. And it is. But that is only the bits that are above the waterline. That's the 10%. That's the little bit above the waterline. See, the good news begins a long time before that. The good news is the entire iceberg. The 90% below the waterline as well. The bits you can't see at first looking at it. The good news is so much bigger than that. It's more than the cross and the resurrection. It's more than the life of Jesus. It is the whole of history. History of everything. And it begins in Genesis 1. Open your Bibles to Genesis 1. We're going to start reading. No, we're not. We don't have that. Genesis 1:1 says this. Bereshit bara Elohim at ha-shamayim wa-at ha-eret. Is that what yours says? More or less. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now I want to, I'm going to upset some people today, and I know that, and that's okay. Come and talk to me later. You are welcome to disagree or argue with me about this at any point. Come and see me. I want to tell you this. Genesis 1, the 3, is not about creation. I'm waiting for the cries of heresy here. It's not about creation. That doesn't come across in the English language, but in Hebrew it's very clear. It is not about creation. Genesis 1 to 3 is about God. And it's about God and his relationship to people. When we look at it and we read it and we unpack what the first three chapters of the Bible are actually saying, it's saying that God wants people to know him. That we are built for relationship with God. That God has designed us so that we can be his friends. This is what Genesis 1 to 3 is all about. As in the story of creation, and every culture in the world has a creation story. But this passage is about God and us. It is the beginning of the gospel. The beginning of the good news. Here is where history begins. Let's turn over a few pages and we'll go through to Genesis 6. I'm going to read you one verse in English this time. Verse 5 of Genesis 6 says this. The Lord saw how great man's wickedness on the earth had become, that every inclination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil all the time. Who wants that read out at their funeral? Probably not many. That every inclination of your heart is evil all the time. But that's probably not something you really want on your tombstone, is it? Here is part of the history of the world. Genesis 6 and 7, of course, is what's the story there? The flood, Noah's flood. And we go through Genesis 11, which is... I'm testing you here, come on. Tower of Babel. And here we have this story. And beginning in Genesis 6, we read that God sees that man's... And woman's, sorry, you don't get off that easily. The man's heart is full of evil. And then in Genesis 11, they say, let's build a tower up to God. And God says, I don't think so. And of course, we know that in the biblical story, he confuses their language and they become communities and they move away and we can trace it from there. But what I find really, really interesting is that at this point, Genesis 11, here is where the history of the world diverges. Here is where the history of the world and of nations starts to become different. I think it's fascinating that when we look at cultures around the world, and whether we talk about specific cultures or groups of cultures or whatever we want to talk about it, every culture has a creation story. Whether it's us in our modern Western European culture, whether it's Australian Aboriginal, whether it's Native American, whether it's South American, whether it's Russian or African, every single culture or group of cultures has a creation story. And they all involve gods of some kind. They all involve people. And every single culture, every group of cultures also has a flood narrative. A story about a great flood that destroys the world. And then from there, we start to see cultures separate. Let's think about that for a moment. If every culture has a creation story, if every culture has a flood story, that means that every culture has its roots in the same area where creation and floods happen. See, here in Genesis 11, this is where the world separates. This is where people and cultures go their own ways and that their histories and their stories start to change. But before that, they're the same story. And we see that reflection in all of these cultures. Okay, so why is that fascinating? Why is that interesting? Well, I'm glad you asked. Genesis 6 to 11 tells us something about us. See, as people, we're not very good at sin. We're great at it. We're fantastic at sin. We not only are we great at sin, and we find ways to perfect old ways of doing sin, like lust and hatred and anger. But we invent new ways of sinning as well. We only got to look around our world and see that every day there's new ways that you can sin. Don't go looking for them. All right? Just trust me. Not sure how I should know, but anyway, let's not go there right now. See, there's always new ways of doing evil because we're so good at it. Every thought and inclination of our hearts. Something about the human condition. When we look at the word sin itself, you know, sin is really not a very nice word in modern language. People think sin is a four-letter word. People don't understand what sin is. And so in modern evangelical circles, you're taught you don't talk about sin. We don't talk about that. We talk about the nice things about God. We don't talk about sin. Well, we have to, because it's part of our nature. In the Hebrew, the word sin is translated from a word which means to trespass, to break a law. The Hebrew is very black and white. Here's the law, you do what you know. That's all there is to it. Very, very simple in the Hebrew. In the Greek, it's different. It means to fall short, to not meet the standard. It's a different concept altogether. And in the Greek and the Hebrew, the concepts don't match up. We start off with breaking laws, and then we get to a point where the Bible tells us about falling short of what God has for us. Now in Romans, Paul talks about those who have the law, or those who don't have the law, become a law for themselves. Paul also talks about God not leaving a culture without a witness to himself. I think what we see, or we make the mistake sometimes of thinking that world history is comprised within the Bible. That's a little bit arrogant of us, don't you think? You think that the only history which counts is what's written in here? See, I have a slide which didn't make sense in the first service, not here, where if we look at the world, when we look at the amount of the world which is taken up in biblical history, you know, you've got an area probably about the size of South Australia. I don't know exactly. But the entirety of the Old Testament happens in an area that big. Well, what about those people living outside of that area? Do they not have a history? Do they not have some way of understanding God? Now, we know that Jesus is God incarnate, that God sends Jesus so we can know Jesus, so we can know God. Here is the good news, encapsulated in one person. But I love that God speaks in all time and all ages. See, we think that the story of God is just as little bit here. Yes, this is the fulfillment of the story of God. Here is where we can know God. But God's story is so much bigger than this. God's story goes throughout the world. I love in, I think it's in Exodus. Might be in Leviticus. The people are going, and God says, don't fight against these people. Don't try to take their land. Because they are the descendants of Ishmael. There we go. There's the world. The descendants of Ishmael. and they are your brothers, and I have a covenant with them. Have you ever read that? God has an agreement or a covenant with these other people. And yet God chooses to use the Hebrew people, ultimately through Jesus, to reveal himself. See, the history of the world, the history of everything, the story of everything is about God. It's about more than just this one people of Israel. And it's about more than just the church. Whether it's this church or all churches. The story of God is so much bigger than that. The story of God starts in Genesis 1 with the very first mother sheep. The very first, in the beginning, we have the story of God being played out in the world. Of God seeking his wayward children, wherever they may be. Whether it's through the laws of the Old Testament, which we see that's very legalistic, don't we? I do or do not, that's all there is to it. But I love the Levitical laws because they are our relationship with God. It is God saying, here is a way that you can know me. See, God has been from the beginning and is always about relationship. This is the story of everything. This is the history of everything. That we were made for God, and that God has made a way for us to know him. Whether we look in grand scale of things with the world and everything which happens in the world, or whether we bring it back to our own lives, the story of God is so much bigger than right here and now. And this is where the history of the world, the history of everything starts to make sense. Because when we recognize that it is God's story played out throughout the ages, throughout the world, in every corner of every nation, that God is at work, wanting to reveal his Son. When we recognize that, it starts to make sense of all the things which happen in the world. Within our lives, when we recognize that God is calling us to walk with him, that this is what our lives are about. They're not about the money or the box. They're not about all of the possessions and everything else. That they're about a relationship with God. And everything starts to fall into place. And our history, our story, makes sense. Because God is at the center. So let me ask you again. What is the good news? It is encapsulated in the cross of Christ. But the good news is that God wants you to know him. That God wants to be your friend. That he has made a way that can happen. Here is the good news. From Genesis through to Revelation. From in the beginning to the final amen. From your birth to your death. Here is the good news, that God is to be your friend. Maybe this is not something you've heard before. Maybe you are struggling to come to grips with the concept that maybe there's a bigger picture than just the cross. If you are, then I invite you to make a time for us to sit down together and discuss it. If you've never realized that your life makes sense when it comes into view with Jesus in the middle, maybe you've been following Jesus and walk with him for such a long time, but you've never actually realized that all these things which happen in your life make sense when we see them through Jesus. And I invite you to make a time to talk about it. Maybe you've never realized that you are part of a bigger picture. That your life is not actually about you. But it's about God at work in your world. And I invite you to make the time and talk about it. right now, we're going to pray. We're going to ask that God reveals this. God makes our lives make sense. Because there's more than just the tip of the iceberg. There's more than just one little area in the world or in our lives. The story of God and the history of everything finds its fulfillment when you find Christ. Let's pray. Father, as we look at the history of the world, there are so many things that we see, and some of which we don't understand. There are so many things in our lives, in our own personal history, that we see and we don't understand. But Lord Jesus, thank you that when we look at the world and at our lives through you, it starts to make sense. That when we see you at the center of our lives, and everything else starts to fade into insignificance. Lord, my prayer is that today you would make our lives make sense. That you would help us to come to terms with our own lives and our own mortality and our own history and our own stories in the light of your story. As you live in us. Because Lord, here is the good news. That we can be your friend. And that you can make our lives make sense. So Lord, draw us on. As individuals and as a church, help us to be that place and that people where our community finds you and therefore finds peace. Thank you for your salvation. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your story lived out in our lives. In Jesus' name.